Greetings, Wolfpack. Catastrophe here, and when I'm not slowly destroying your childhood innocence for a cheap thrill, I'm uncovering underrated classics that deserve more love and attention than the mainstream garbage gets. We've had a lot of fun torching meh-mediocre merchandise this year, but let's finally talk about something good for a change. Such as, you know it, the Aqua Teen Hunger Force. And what perfect timing too, since it's the Aqua Teen Hunger Force's 20-year anniversary! Wow, 20 years ago on this very day, one of the funniest cartoons ever made first aired on Adult Swim, and it lasted for almost 2 decades. Earning 11 seasons, 140 episodes, a guest spot on Space Ghost, and a movie. This show was so bizarre, but it was a dang explosive phenomena. I loved it. The series was basically a morbid hybrid of Teen Titans Go and regular show, but for adults. However, it had its own distinct style, which made it a quite unique, trippy experience as well. But some of you might be asking, hey Cat, you sexy feline you, what is the Aqua Teen Hunger Force? Well, to the like 5 of you who never watched this excellent comedy tune, the Aqua Teen Hunger Force was an absurdist screwball comedy featuring talking food products, getting into wild adventures, and simply overcoming random insanity which crashes their way. We followed Master Shake, the brain-dead douche leader wannabe, Frylock, the scientific snarky straight man, Meatwad, the dim-witted goofball of meat, and occasionally their fat, stupid neighbor, Carl, having their lives interrupted by the creepy stuff that happens in New Jersey. There was never really any plot or long story arcs. It was mostly an episodic series where the iconic characters get wrapped up in some wacky hijinks. Heck, there wasn't even any continuity on the show. The main characters practically died in every episode, only to come back to life the next day like nothing happened at all. It was weird, but still hella funny. Definitely sets a good taste for dark comedy.
Well, that's what I and the computer both know.
Mm-hmm. Well then, know this.
I think what I loved the most about the show was that it usually parodied horror and sci-fi tropes. Since they paid homage to a lot of the writings you'd find in those grim genres, yet played it all for sweet, disturbing laughs, many of which made the greatest episodes ever. That's where I come in. It's so hard to pinpoint which episodes of the Aqua Teens were better than others, because there are so many fantastic ones to choose from, but I think I have a good idea which were the best of the best, and that's the purpose of this list, obviously. These were my top 10 favorite Aqua Teen tales, and I think they are flawless comedies for people to appreciate, or at least watch to see if the show is their flavor. Now, seeing as this is a top 10 list, there's a high chance an episode or two that you love might not be on here. Well, too bad. Go make your own, because this is all my opinion. Take it or leave it. 20 years of the Aqua Teens have passed by, so of course this was going to be a tough list to write. By the way, I'm not counting the movie or those commercial shorts of Carl. Actual TV episodes only.
You bastards.
I admire the Aqua Teen Hunger Force, but what episodes of a dark horror comedy where stupidity remains supreme should count as the show's masterpieces? Well, let's stop babbling and find out. These are my top 10 best Aqua Teen Hunger Force episodes.
Tonight's episode,
Less dance for Napkin Lad.
A lot of people have mocked the heck out of the Aqua Teen Hunger Force's animation designs, crying how it's so cheap and lazy. But what if I told you that this episode alone actually upgraded the show's style to over-the-top extremes? Oh yeah, this is where the Aqua Teen Hunger Force got a huge boost in their productions, and it shows. But that's not all. The comedy in this episode is just pure crazy awesomeness. As usual, the Aqua Teens start off in their typical boring daily routines until it's revealed that all the characters are secretly master spies, who've spent the last couple of seasons playing this long cat-and-mouse game the whole time, before blowing up in all-out war. Essentially, the characters act like they were secret badass Solid Snake and James Bond archetypes all along, and naturally, get into a complex, stupid death battle, filled with violence, scheming, betrayals, the works. The big joke is that the show itself is nothing like this at all, yet they act like, oh, it was always like this all along, and our buffoons here were totes epic deep down. And boy, is it just as funny as it sounds.
Oh, but I can't say.
Maybe you shouldn't try.
So you did kill Napkin Lad, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. And he cried like a little bitch when I gutted him.
Not to nitpick, but in some areas, this episode is also called Spy, because executives are morons. This isn't a bad thing, but it just might confuse some audiences. There's also this character named Napkin Lad who pops up at times, but don't worry, he's not a real main character or anything. He's just in this episode alone to fill up the spy cliches. He's still a pretty funny addition, though, since he plays off of Evil Carl so well.
Computer, in the dive mode.
You can't do that! It's just a prototype! It's never been tested for undersea battle!
Then I guess we're gonna test it then, aren't we, Napkin Lad?
You're a madman!
It's good to be something.
Everyone is on their A-game for this plot. The comedy is so overblown that you won't even have time to stop laughing in between the thousands of gags literally shot at you. All the characters have time to shine, their random humor piles on, and you are never bored for a second. Most people who tell me that they don't like the show often cite the slower random humor as a weakness, but this episode managed to turn it up to the 11 on the madness meter. It's so goofy that it's awesome. While it's not as big a name as some of the other tales, this one will take you on one heck of a ride.
What should we do?
How about you start by calling the president and telling him you're fired? Because I'm taking over from here.
Wait a minute. No, don't!
For behold, the ultimate chick magnet!
So, shock of all shocks, this plot is a weird episode too. Yeah, get used to weird episodes in this show, since it's 99% of the franchise. In this story, Shake buys a ginormous machine that can make him a chick magnet, since he can't get any action. However, it turns out that the magnet has a toxic radiation affecting our bros, slowly forcing them to act like, for the lack of a better word, a feminine. And this is what makes this episode so freaking hilarious. The Aqua Teen Hunger Force, who are the most foul-mouthed, psychotic, mean-spirited bunch of lunatics ever, suddenly begin to act like sensitive teenage girls. That sentence alone makes this episode pure solid platinum. Seeing the deranged cartoon characters behaving real prissy and stereotypically girly girl is just so funny. And if there are any ladies watching this, then please, don't take offense to this. I'm not trying to hurt anyone's feels by saying that the Aqua Teens act like sensitive women. Since this is the joke, not only are the characters acting like women, it gets to the point where they literally believe they are women. It's that ludicrous.
Brunch?
No brunch for me. I feel bloated.
Oh, Oof. Listen to him. Skinny as a rail. He'll never stop.
Yeah, you know me. I just get a little crazy during my period. My period.
Frylock.
Yep, Shake's magic chick magnet is broken and causing a shift in everyone's personas while the heroes desperately struggle to fight it. This leads to a whole lot of stupid fun and new shenanigans that the Aqua Teens would have never done before. Seeing Shake and Frylock going from cynical jerks into dorky teenage girls is the highlight of this episode, and it's what made it one of my favorites since it's so out there. And just like the spy episode, everyone gets a funny moment to shine in this. Even Carl in his one scene.
All of a sudden, for no reason at all, I feel very fat.
This episode is such a delightful change of pace for the mean-spirited misfits here, and if seeing them act as the polar opposite of their usual personas doesn't seem like fun to you, then I don't know what will. As silly as this tale is, it'll definitely draw you in with its sheer animal magnetism.
Why the f*** are we in a fabric store?
Cause he said, we gonna get a... I hate the fabric store.
It's not a sandwich at all, Shake. It's the Brood Witch.
The Brood Witch?
No, the Brood Witch, Meatwad! Brood Witch!
Wait, say what?
Brood Witch!
The Blair Witch is here!
Yeah, if you're an Aqua Teen fan, then you all knew this was coming. The Brood Witch was a simple, yet intriguing taste of the show's insane creativity. One day, while trolling Master Shake with a fake treasure map, as you do, the moronic milkshake accidentally digs his way into hell, where he finds the Brood Witch, a sandwich of death. You see, Shake has been chosen by the sandwich to be killed, and whenever he takes a bite out of the unhappy meal, he gets sent to hell, where he's attacked by plankton. The sandwich will continuously compel him to eat it until it and him are finished. And the entire narrative of this episode is Shake trying to fight or give in to the magic sandwich's power, as well as getting into wacky banter with some casual hell demons. Everyone remembers the famous scene where Shake listens in on Plankton and Bob Belcher's long casual small talk, and the demonic Satan voice egging the Aqua Teens on. But it is so surreal that you can't deny how entertaining it is. I think something that made this tale so entrancing is how the Aqua Teen Hunger Force had some sweet gothic artwork and new effects for the show. The Plankton Hell World looks so unique, and seeing the show seamlessly morphing Shake into different animations is quite impressive. And of course, the comedy in this episode is still on point.
I tasted mustard.
Yeah, Dijon mustard.
Well, how come no bacon?
Bacon is extra.
You call this a sandwich? You don't have bacon on it?
Pretty much the greatest mark in this episode is how casual everyone is about the disturbing situations. What made it so funny was how all the characters downplay the hell concepts and treat it all as a minor inconvenience. Heck, even the hell demons just discuss things like it was a normal day job, but it's so funny that you can't look away. The sandwich might embody insanity, yet this episode embodies the hilarity of the Aqua Teen's uncaring worldview. I guess much like the Brood Witch itself, this tale is a tempting sample which you simply can't refuse.
Congratulations! You passed the test! You've fended off the last temptation of the Brood Witch!
Really? Hey, why do I win? Hell no! I'm not marrying this bag of bones!
Seriously?
Yes.
Number one in the hood, Jim.
The shaving. The shaving.
I'm calling the cops.
That's right, the Aqua Teen Hunger Force had a Halloween special. And naturally, it was outstanding enough to become a massive fan favorite. In this nightmare, the Aqua Teens find out that they have a monster living in their attic. an onion spider demon thing dubbed Willie Nelson.
Willie Nelson?
Well, not the Willie Nelson. But my name is Willie Nelson.
But sadly, he sucks at being scary, and is taken seriously by nobody. So Master Shake takes him under his wing to mentor him in the ways of being a great horror villain. Where, of course, wacky hijinks soon follow. What makes this story so endearing is that Willy the Spider Demon is such a nice, chill guy who honestly tries to befriend the Aqua Teens, acting so naive and kind, yet also trying to be taught how to act scary, from our favorite psychopath Shake. Almost a cute moment in a sense. It was kind of rare to see Shake caring for other people, since he's usually depicted as, pardon my French, a sociopathic maniac. I kind of like seeing Shake helping somebody for a change. In his own twisted way, of course, but his interactions with the monster are very comedic. Especially since he's trying to guide him on being a real horror monster. Much like the Brood Witch, everything in this episode is mostly played as a matter-of-factly simple story, where the main characters treat this bizarreness as another average Tuesday. Which naturally makes it super funny, especially since the monster is played off as a pushover nice guy, while all the other major characters are the over-the-top insane ones. It's just so humorous, and Willie Nelson is real likable, so you do hope he wins out in the end. Plus, we as always get the wacky antics of the Aqua Teen screwing around.
Lower the blood.
Which lever is it? There's like three of them.
I said do it! Okay, I got it.
Hey, you hear me?
The episode mocks a ton of monster story cliches too, and also kind of feels like a sweet treat to horror fans, since Shake makes a lot of references and shoutouts to scary movies, which I for one enjoy to no end. And like in all great horror stories, there's a powerful twist ending. If you've seen this episode, then you know precisely what I'm talking about, but for the sake of the newbies, I won't spoil it. Just know that you're in for something shocking. Other than the famous ending, this episode is a good old love letter to everyone who loves horror and Halloween mishaps. It was a close shave, but this tale is still one of the show's juiciest treats.
Nice head, I think. Oh, crap.
What? What do you want?
Yeah, what do you want?
What are you doing here?
I live here, ass.
Do you even know how people get pregnant?
No, but I know how I did. I was touched by the power on my unit in broad daylight.
This is the episode where Meatwad gets pregnant. Okay, there is much more to it than that. This story is basically a big take that towards those religious nuts who feel offended by everything and breathe in way too much into TV shows. Simply because they feel that their beliefs are attacked by a work of fiction. In this episode, everyone in town believes they see the Son of God's face on a billboard, and assume that it's a sign of a higher power, leading to many strange things happening around Jersey. Well, stranger than the usual Aqua Teen madness. Meatwad becomes magically impregnated somehow, and believes that he's giving birth to an angel, leading to all the typical stupid elements we know and love from the series. This episode also has the best and most remarkable bit of this whole franchise, which in my eyes still holds up so much relevance by today. The standards and practices scene. In George Lowe's greatest performance here, the writers unapologetically poke fun of how people are too sensitive and easily offended by everything, to the point where the show has to censor itself in order to not trigger people. Yes, for reals, the Aqua Teen Hunger Force is lecturing people on what's right for television and having a friggin' ball with with it. This scene is legendary and makes us laugh even by today.
Although not nearly as funny, it's guaranteed not to offend the black people.
No, unacceptable.
Ooh, did I say black? I meant to say minorities.
Acceptable.
Oh, Aqua Teens never change. Although a small moment, this scene is essentially the writers winking to their fans to not take their content too seriously. Since ultimately, it's all just all in good, stupid fun, with no ill will intended. Which is what made the show so popular to begin with, since it's never been taken seriously at all, and the shenanigans are just so dumb that of course we know it's all a jolly fun time. The jabs it makes at those deluded religious nuts is also mega funny. Meatwad and Shake are truly invested in the blatant nonsense going on, while Frylock, the smart guy, does basic studying of what's been happening and fails to talk some sense into his moronic roommates. A pretty timeless joke, since we're all too familiar with people taking every little thing in life way too intensely. As you can guess, Pregnant Meatwad is also as laugh-out-loud silly as it gets.
Maybe I should get a steak knife and etch it in your mother forehead. How hard can it be? Ass mother queen. I guess that's the price I paid for living with two morons.
What happened to courtesy?
This episode surprisingly contains more clever moments than given credit for, yet has the typical randomness humor, making it fun to absorb. While full of its absurd antics, this episode is simply an out-of-this-world experience.
Well, I'm sure glad that wasn't blood. I would have been mother offended out of my ass.
Me too, you mother suck.
Acceptable.
Number one in the hood, yeah.
No, we didn't see it. Everything's fine. I'll just shut up and I'll get us cool controller.
Well, the Aqua Teen writers must really love horror stories a lot, because this was another affectionate scary story parody. But a pretty dang awesome one. In this episode, Master Shake blows up one TV set too many, forcing the Aqua Teens to clone another Tubi, even when Frylock warns them that it's very dangerous. You see, Frylock owns a cloning machine. Like all of us, right? However, since he's been making the same thing over and over and over again, the structure of the clone objects begins to malfunction, causing some of the clone test subjects to come out different. Shock of all shocks, they ignore the Fryman and do it anyway, 'cause they're morons. Little do they know that they've created an evil TV set. And oddly enough, the evil TV set is surprisingly creepy. They actually play the horror monster as a real unsettling threat, while the comedy mainly comes from the Aqua Teens being too stupid to combat it. Yet it's very unnerving.
Look at that!
Yes, I see that.
Look at that, you're on a TV.
Well, you know, I've been on TV a lot. See, this, this is my sitcom with
I'm in your house.
The haunted TV soon influences the Aqua Teens to give in to some evil, harebrained schemes, leading to Shake and even Frylock trying to clone money and growing greedy as a result. However, it also shows horrifying visions of Frylock turning evil! While mostly displaying the random goofiness, this episode morphs into a Twilight Zone parody rather quickly, and you get more and more curious to see where it goes. And as usual, the comedy is also extremely well written.
Don't let him in.
No, come on in.
Oh, it is him, but just don't ask him to dance.
Do you want to dance?
I'd love to dance.
You ask him to dance! I told you not to ask him to dance!
You shut up.
Oh, God.
Things soon start to take a dark turn, though, when we see that the images shown in the TV's world slowly start to happen in the real world. And I'll leave it at that. The cloning is one of their more intense, yet still clever Twilight Zone-esque parodies, where it seems as if the show knew how to raise the stakes in it. While the Aqua Teens have never been that tightly knit a family, seeing them blow up at each other and devolve into even crazier bad guys is certainly quality drama. This is a terrific horror comedy that can never truly be replicated.
Something wrong with that TV.
There's nothing wrong with that TV. Okay, something's wrong with that.
Number one in the hood, G.
Aw yeah, the Aqua Teen Hunger Force crosses paths with Slappy the Dummy. I know we just had a good horror parody episode in the last spot, but this one is even better. The Aqua Teen Hunger Force does, what else? A killer doll story. Where a knockoff Slappy the Dummy is magically delivered to the guys, leading to all the stupid shenanigans we know and love. What makes this episode funny is that the killer doll is never taken in as a genuine threat by the protagonists, and they simply feel annoyed by him. They set up every horror cliche in the book, yet the dummy is such an unimpressive killer doll that the Aqua Teens never notice that he wants to kill them, leading to tons of comedy surplus.
Have you seen my collectible axe? Oh, there it is! Hey, that looks great on you!
If you can believe it or not, the Aqua Teens try doing the smart move by getting rid of the dummy, but for some reason he keeps coming back to life and won't ever leave them alone. A huge jab at every horror franchise ever right there. It gets so hilarious that it even leads to two killer dummies entering the picture, ramping up the humor even further than the cloning did.
Who is giving out free dummies in his neighborhood?
If you love the show's horror stories, then this one is the greatest of them all, for its non-stop silliness, jabs at the horror genre, charming acting, and good sense of dark humor. Master Shake and Meatwad's banter being the best part of this short. The episode actually gets funnier and funnier as it goes on, making it an absolutely unpredictable trip for a parody of retro horror tales. If you've ever seen a killer doll story, or heck, a horror story in general, you will laugh at least one joke in this. But I thought everything landed victoriously in this episode, making it one of my favorites of the series. What more can I say, but the writers puppeteered a brilliant showstopper that didn't need any strings attached.
Well, I gotta run to dinner. You guys have fun. I'll be gone just long enough for something to happen. But if anything does, don't use the phone. Because I just cut the line. Later, haters!
Shake, I'm very sorry that I thought about doing what you said I was about to do, but didn't. And I'm sorry too.
Now we're getting into some of Meatwad's best material on the show. In this episode, while trying to kill his roommate, Shake accidentally causes Meatwad to gain the power to clone himself when he gets split apart. And if you thought one Meatwad was a ton of fun, well, now we get to see an army of Meatwads. Basically, the whole episode is about Meatwad multiplying to the point where there's too many of him to handle, and he spends all his screen time annoying the heck out of everyone with his clone army. That's about it. A simple premise, but it evolves into a colossal overload of ridiculousness that you can't help but laugh at how the other characters grow tired of his split personalities.
Call it in the air.
I'd rather you call it in the air.
I don't want to call it in the air. That's too much responsibility.
Well, I don't want to call it in the air.
But if we call it in the air, then that means someone would win. And I want you to win.
But I want you to win.
Get the f*** in here. You're wasting all the heat.
Meatwad is one of the best characters on the show, and seeing him recreating too many Pinkie Pies was an impressive joy to behold. My favorite part of this episode is the time skip. Sorry for the spoilers, but this episode actually has a time skip where we see the future of the Aqua Teens, unexpectedly going to different places in their lives. Meatwad's clone troopers waste their existence, Shake is tortured for years putting up with them, and Frylock becomes a huge success. It's amazingly cool that we see the Aqua Teens in an alternate timeline of sorts, since even that continues on the wacky antics. And if you follow our channel, then you know that this was my favorite scene.
Drop by anytime.
I probably won't.
What?
I said I probably won't.
One more time.
Never mind.
Are you there? Asshole!
Elderly Shake never loses his moxie. I know it's kinda biased since I'm a huge Meatwad fan, but truth be told, it is a funny plot where all the characters gain humorous reactions to the clone nightmare. While some people might blow this tale off as nothing special, I think it's perfect at proving why Meatwad is one of a kind.
I got messed up. Start over. Gentlemen, we have the technology. We can rebuild him.
And there you go, Carl.
Welp, you know it's not an Aqua Teen Hunger Force love letter without having Carl's best title listed. I know we haven't reached number one, but I'll just say it. This is, pause down, the funniest episode of the Aqua Teen saga. It is another gut-busting psychotic riot. The humor is pure gold, the characters are all funny, the setup is so crazy, and the conflict might be the most unique of the series, and that's saying a lot. In this episode, Frylock tests his new experimental super toilet on his only human buddy, Carl, to see if it's safe to sell on the market. But uh-oh, the toilet accidentally kills Carl. Well, of course. So, in order to escape punishment for killing a man, the Aqua Teens try to resurrect Carl back to life, and give him a new body. A better body. A body that can allow him to resume his life like nothing bad occurred whatsoever. But as you can assume, they hit some bumps in the road.
Chief, where do you want this?
You drove that thing through town.
It's cool, I stayed on the shoulder the whole way.
Well, at least bring it through the back, damn.
Go ahead, bring it through the front and back.
Damn it, Shake!
You said the back! What is this, the front now?
This might be the show's funniest sci-fi parody ever, because the Aqua Teens make a lot of dark body horror jokes that are more laughable than they should be.
Hello, is anyone here? Why do my knees feel like they want to tear up?
I think what sells this episode as so memorable is some of the goofy visuals and creative writing. The show has so much fun with this premise, and it is exciting to watch how far they go and where they're even heading to next. This tale showcases everything that made the Aqua Teen Hunger Force series so great. The stylish artwork, the dark comedy, the perfect timing, and a riveting plot. You simply can't build a greater absurdist grim misadventure than this.
I give you the ultimate in military hardware, complete with laser cannon, indestructible titanium exoskeleton, and motion-activated plasma pulse rifles.
And you're gonna plug him in?
You're right. Damn, what the hell was I thinking?
Before we get to our finale, here are a few honorable mentions.
Look at you. You're thinking about stealing our shirt, aren't you?
I'm thinking about it. Yes. I could go make you something in our haunted kitchen.
Bonzo! We're on family.
Heck, I admit, he is kind of cute.
Tonight, you.
Boop, 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 boop.
What the? Meatwad!
He's gone. That thing took him.
Back up. I'm going in after him.
Deep within the walls
time a creed should thus be born. The seed of life is united with the ink of tyranny.
Contact him with instant pestering. It's only an additional $9.95
a month.
What
kind of note did you not understand?
Where am I?
Welcome to Canada, Frylock.
Seize him!
Oh no, Yom Kippur!
One hundred.
Hey, we better go.
See you soon.
And now our number one.
This is impossible. There's no way you're better than me. I'm allergic to shellfish.
Yep, what else deserves appreciation from fans but none other than the series finale of the Aqua Teens. Alright, technically there was a second series finale episode after this, but I think this one was much superior, since it has a shockingly heartwarming conclusion. For once in the entirety of the Aqua Teen show's run, our main characters finally come face to face with a serious life-changing story arc. We find out that Frylock is dying. The magic jewel we always see on his back has apparently a small amount of energy left. This jewel not only gave him his superpowers, but it kept him alive this whole time, meaning that Frylock's life is running out. However, these jewels are actually from a hostile alien planet dominated by talking French clams, and the only way he can live is if he steals a power gem from a mother clam. Yep, it only makes too much sense. Unfortunately, he can't do it alone, and his buddies are too stupid to be of any aid, so he's kind of screwed. Frylock has always been the lovable yet serious guy in the group who kept the others united, but the idea that he's really going to die, especially in the final episode of the show, just hurts. Not only that, but we discover that all of the Aqua Teens had power jewels too, and without them they become mortals, which the show suggests is permanent. No more dying and coming back to life the next day. This is truly the last adventure. Of course, they attempt the suicide mission anyway, but the group really sours.
No! Thief! I need it! For survival!
What the hell you think I need it for?
No! Give it. Jewel burglar!
Frylock, no, step back. It's his jewel.
But he's a dick! He's always been a dick!
Lower the wall, meatwad! I'm about to do some drilling into someone's head!
So, half this episode is the Aqua Teens coming to grips with their mortal coil, angsting about the end, and even forming a bucket list to do everything they can, just in case they don't come back from their space mission. It's really sad and tragic, since this is the end of our favorite show. But naturally, there's some last laughs along the way.
Don't tell me to get my finger out my butt!
No, I won't tell you to get your finger out your butt. Hell, I'll put my finger in your butt. We'll have fingers in butts. Come on, man, let's dance.
Luckily, Meatwad reveals that he's actually smarter than the others gave him credit for, and he can successfully perform the jewel recovery mission. Frylock constructs a spaceship for them, but he becomes too sick to take off, meaning that our idiots are on the case. And as you can guess, many heartfelt goodbyes and moronic slapstick soon follows. This episode was a masterful final send-off of our beloved sociopathic heroes. There's one last job with their craziness and fun, but also a decent wave goodbye to all the folks who made this show so famous. Not trying to spoil everything, but this was the part so awesome that you can't ignore discussing it. We have another anime time skip, where we see what Meatwad accomplished in his now mortal life. He was actually able to get a family and a job and a normal life after cleaning up his act. While it's certainly cheesy, this has some nice callbacks to some of the show's greatest moments.
Our neighbor here used to always get cheesed off whenever we'd swim in here or crush his house with a giant Easter egg monster. One time we killed him with a toilet and replaced him with eyeballs.
I know it's so overdone to have distant future endings, but considering that the Aqua Teens never had deep emotional moments that we were supposed to embrace seriously, this was a rather touching way to wrap up. I won't go in more depth, but the Meatwad family was super sweet. The show was never treated as a deep, intense wonder, but it sure as heck knew how to leave with a bang, which is why I value it as the best episode ever. While the show had many supreme titles under its belt, their big finish firework here is the prime reason why I say Aqua Teen Hunger Force forever.
Hunger Force. It's the end.
And those were my personal top 10 best Aqua Teen Hunger Force episodes. This show managed to achieve its 20-year anniversary, and while many saw it as a mindless, stupid cartoon, it was still great enjoyment overall, just for the minor pro of being fun and creative. Still dumb, but a fun kind of dumb. So, what did you think? Did you agree with this list? Were there any that you still didn't get into? What are your favorite episodes? Well, feel free to post in the comments section, 'cause Kitty needs a cat nap. Remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe, or just tune in for more videos posted here on Wolf Entertainment. I'm your host, Catastrophe, and I wish the Aqua Teen fans a happy anniversary. And you better be listening to me, or I'll eat your brain!
Truly, they were an Aqua Teen Hunger Force.
Your emergency brake is on!
Don't tell me how to drive, jackass!